Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome all to the regular scheduled council meeting for March 6, 2017 at 6:30 p.m. For you, there's a lot of people here more than normal, which is a good thing regardless. So if anybody has cell phones, just do us a favor, turn them down and put them on vibrate if you would, please. And once again, thank you for coming tonight. We appreciate it. We'd like to see all the faces. So that being said, Mr. Collier, you can go with the roll.
Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsay?
Here.
Mr. Leidy?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Lethley?
Here.
Mr. Craybrock?
Here.
All members present.
Thank you, sir. All right, tonight we'll have the invocation by Pastor Andrew Wright.
God, it's been a good day. Thank you so much for being with us. You are God of all seasons and in all times. We thank you for these folk in our community who have been elected to serve us. We pray you'll give them wisdom and guidance and counsel. And for us as citizens, Lord, may we be responsible also as citizens of this fair town. Bless this meeting, bless this time in your name. Amen.
All right, we'll do the pledge tonight. We'll use the flag here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
On the regular scheduled council meeting minutes for February 21st, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Craybrock and Mr. Reynolds.
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
I red-lighted.
Motion by Mr. Craybrock, or second by Mr. Lindsay, correct?
By Mr. Reynolds.
Second
by
Mr. Reynolds.
Any discussion or comments on the minutes, council?
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Craybrock?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Minutes past 7-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on, communications, London Lights will move down to the city manager's report. Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of the public. Great to see such a great turnout today. City manager's report for this council meeting kind of got a lot to discuss. I want to hold it all off to town hall. But under informational items, we do have a communication from Mark White, president of Van Crest Management, in regards to Van Crest paying for the phase one and asbestos study. As we can see, he'd be willing to do that, but he would have to take off some of the furniture and other fixtures they were going to donate to us free of charge as well. So we do have hearing back that it sounds like they're not willing to pay for it. If they do want, we do want them to pay for it, they will just deduct it from what they're going to give us as far as furniture items and stuff like that. Any questions on that email from members of council?
Thank you for sending the letter.
No
I appreciate it.
It was more of a personal discussion at the open house, but we did have Jake Jeffries send a letter to their attorney as well. But okay. I did speak with Mark White person to person.
Okay, thank you, Randy.
Not a problem at all. I'll check with. We are just about done. There's still maybe one or two glitches that we need to get alleviated. It's still in review mode. I have been in communication with Mr. Burton at the state auditor's office. He said whenever we're ready to roll it out, we're going to roll it out. We're looking at a two-week delay. Hopefully we'll get those glitches fixed here soon and be able to launch that at the next council meeting. Congressman Warren Davidson will hold mobile office hours at the city building the fourth Tuesday of each month from 2 p.m. until 2:30 p.m. So if you want to come and sit with his representative in that half-hour time frame, you at the city building, just located right in front of the lobby. And that all I have. That's all I have for the city manager's report. I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
Councilman Reynolds.
Speaking of talking to Mr. Burton from Treasurer Mandel's office, I had spoke to him, you know, and he had said there was some problems with Amazon, so that was when they went down for 2 days. That's why our checkbook wasn't able to be updated at the meeting, at this meeting, like it was supposed to be, because when Amazon goes down, the entire system goes down.
It was Thursday.
I just want to make sure to clarify why.
Yeah, Thursday I was trying to get it loaded, just would load and load and load and fail and fail and fail. So let's get them figured that out. The server issue was it for us, it was more some of the display items we didn't like and how it was worded. So the server issue I think was alleviated, but we're just trying to get the fine print a little better for us. But thank you for the answer. Much appreciated.
Council, any other questions or comments from the city manager? Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Appreciate it. All right, moving on to comments from the members of the public. Before we move on to that, I just wanted to, I think everyone here tonight is aware we're going to have a town hall at 7. So this is completely up to you guys. This is your turn. If you want to speak, ask questions, do what you want to do. Or if you want, you can wait until we get to the town hall person. It's either way. So if anyone does have any questions or comments, now would be your time to go to the podium, give us your name and address, and you can make any statements or questions or comments or anything you may have.
Can I add something to that?
Mr. Craybaugh.
I just want to add something to that, and tell me if I'm right in saying this. If you want to talk about the water tower, the water rates, can we hold that off to the town hall?
Well, I don't think we can stop them from doing it. I mean, if you would like to do it during this meeting, you're more than welcome. But I know it's going to get discussed in a lot more depth probably in the town hall.
Right.
So. But if you would like to discuss it now, you're more than welcome to. So it looks like most people are going to hold off for the town hall at 7. Yep. Got one? All right. Just your name and address. Oh,
two.
We got two. Just your name and address, please.
My name is Misty Hedrick. I live at 831 Bell Oak Street.
Okay.
I received a zoning violation for a potbelly pig I've had at my property as of next month will be 2 years. I apparently had one complaint in 2 years, and I was told that I have to get rid of my pig. She is an indoor animal. She stays in our house. She goes out into the backyard, which is a privacy fence, and plays in the backyard and comes in like a dog or a cat. I'm told that she is livestock. However, I have several reports that state that she is considered a companion pet and not, she is a pig, I agree, but she is a smaller breed of pig, and nowadays they are considered pets. I don't honestly care if you change the ordinance. I want to keep my pet. I've had her for 2 years now.
Okay.
And the city has also known that I've had her. She's not been hidden. She's been out in the neighborhood. She's been out in our yard when we're out there. So they've known that she's there.
Okay. Mr. Bridge, did you want to touch on that at all as far as how that process works? And
our code enforcement officer had tagged her for having that type of animal in city limits. It's pretty clear in the ordinance that, it says you can't have that particular member of the family in the city limits. I spoke with the citizen on the phone, told her to come to the council meeting to voice her opinion. That is a policy change. That's going to be up to the 7 members of council.
Mm-hmm.
But it's no different than when the chicken thing came up a couple years ago. I really feel for her situation. It's out of my realm. It
truly
is.
Right. Mr.
Lane. What was the complaint?
That she was a nuisance. Apparently, one of our neighbors was wrote up for a lot of trash outside. After that, there was a complaint that there was a pig at our house. City has known that. Most of the people around our house know that. I have a total of 250 signatures here in New Carlisle petitioning to keep my pig. I have walked around the neighborhood. I have had numerous people tell me they did not even know there was a pig there. They have no problem with it. As long as it's not running around stray like the dogs and the stray cats that are running around the neighborhood, they could care less what happens in my yard. My home is not filthy. It is not nasty. My backyard, no one can see from the street. There is a privacy fence.
I'll say something. I've raised livestock my whole life.
Mm-hmm.
I always take animals to the fair. My concern is about a pig in the city limits. I'm just talking, just to get yourself prepared for it. This may not be even something the city can do. We can vote on it, but it's not so much a small town thing. You might want to get on the USDA website, which I don't know if
I've already been on there.
Are you aware about APHIS?
Yes.
Okay, are you aware about the OAWA?
Yes.
Okay, so you understand that they do consider potbelly pigs as livestock.
Actually, I have a report from the USDA that says that they are not considered livestock. They are now categorized as pets.
Okay. Can I interject?
Yeah, she is considered an exotic animal is how they categorize her.
Okay. And that's how it comes down. It's an exotic animal, also it's a member of the pig family, so it's a sticky situation.
It is.
Mr. Reynolds.
Now, one thing that if this council chooses not to repeal the ordinance, one thing you can do is per our charter, you can actually go petition with your 200 signatures and do a ballot initiative or referendum, and you can actually introduce an initiative to change the law for you to allow this pig. That's an option that you have at your disposal. So I just want to make sure that's clear. Like, if any citizen wants to change any law or propose a law, you have the right by getting, I think it is 10% of the last gubernatorial election, which would be roughly 150 votes, signatures that need to be validated.
Okay.
And Mr. Collier, who's sitting up here with the glasses and sweater vest, we're the only one who would help direct you with that.
I have that, and I've done literally on this side of lake. I haven't even been across the street.
Okay, yeah, but you have to have like a certain format of your petition.
That's fine.
With like a certain ballot language, but this would be the man to talk to.
And that's fine. I will start over if I need to.
Missy, how do you spell your last?
H-E-D-R-I-C-K.
R-I-C-K, okay. What was your address again?
831 Bell Oak Street.
My only concern, I'm sorry, Gene, was you done?
Yeah, where's Bell Oak Street?
Between North and Deerfield.
We are between Orth and Deerfield. There are literally two houses on the street, and we are the only ones living there. The neighbor has moved. Her house is in foreclosure.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
My only concern was as far as, you know, and I have no doubt that you keep up with the animal. I'm reading some of the messages and stuff coming across social media, but the thing is, and we hear this all the time, is some people ruin it for others. I mean, we see posts and posts on social media of dogs, I don't think it was in town, but a peacock recently.
Right.
And even not long ago, I think it was on spinning, there were four chickens walking around the street.
And that's my thing. I'm not fighting battles for anyone. I'm fighting to keep my animal that I've had for 2 years.
Right.
That's what I'm here for. She is our family pet. We've grown attached to her, and I don't want to get rid of her. Had we just got her, that would be different.
Right.
But considering we've had her for 2 years in the city, I don't know that you personally have known, but I know a lot of people in the city have known that we've had her.
Okay.
And there's been no complaints, no problems whatsoever. When we walk her outside, everybody says, oh, she's so cute, and they come up and pet her and everything else. So I'm at a loss right now.
Yeah, I completely understand. I would, what they suggested is just, start the process and what you need to do.
Okay.
That's what I would.
I think that's your only option is what Ethan suggested. Let's go ahead and try to get that written up and try to get things changed. Because otherwise, you did bring in a pig without it being allowed. Mm-hmm. So hopefully you understand.
I'm not the only one in town that has a pig. Well, I just feel that it's ridiculous that I'm the only one that it was picked out that my pig, there was a complaint, so therefore I have to get rid of her. And I was only given 7 days to get rid of her, which is actually not possible. Considering she is a little bit overweight and she is 2 years old, most people want little itty bitty cute potbelly pigs, and she's cute to us. Other people look at her like, oh my goodness. So for me to get rid of her in that amount of time, I would have to send her to a farm, which she will not survive. She's not used to the cold, and she's not used to the extreme heat either.
Well, and help educate other people. Before you bring livestock into city limits, check to see if it's okay with the city beforehand. And you're doing about this very respectfully, but try to get it changed.
Okay.
And I'm kind of on the fence about it. Like Mr. Mayor said, I'm sure you're an excellent caregiver. I just worry about other people bringing in livestock.
And I understand that.
My concern, and it has nothing to do with you, but don't know your animal at all. We have miniature donkeys, we have miniature horses, we have miniature buffalo, we have all kinds of things that are now called pets.
Yes.
We could be opening a Pandora's box.
Yes.
So from that standpoint, understand the repercussions that probably you're going to face when you bring this to a vote. So I personally don't care, but it would be, I think it would present a problem to pass that kind of an ordinance, because it would basically tell everybody, bring your livestock into DuCarl.
But isn't everyone responsible to take care of their own yard? Isn't all of the neighbors and all of the community supposed to take care of their own property and take care of their yard and keep it clean?
It's also up to the city to make sure that city health ordinances are abided by.
That is true, and you have a lot of homes and areas in this neighborhood that need cleaned up.
And we can nitpick about all kinds of different things.
Yes.
To go into the yes, but this and but that.
Yes.
The fact is, the law says you can't have a farm animal in the city.
But she's not a farm animal.
Unfortunately, she is. She's a pig.
The USDA says she's not.
And unfortunately, I mean, to give you a little background, I raise hogs all my life. I put myself through college raising hogs.
Yes.
So I understand swine better than anybody in this room, probably. And it's pig.
And, well, I have veterinarians and a lot of other people that tell me otherwise.
I understand. So well, if you've got a veterinarian that says it's not a pig, you've got the wrong kind of veterinarian. It's a pig.
Well, it is a pig, but it's not considered livestock.
Okay.
So.
Okay, I...
Ms. Flower.
Okay, I sympathize with you. I truly do. But as a council person, I can't sit here and say, okay, we have an ordinance and we're just going to throw it out the window.
Right.
Okay, but my question is this. Ethan, you spoke about the process to go through. How long does that process take?
To petition?
Uh-huh.
Just depends on how long it takes to get signatures.
Okay, and when is the next election?
It would be May. Yeah.
Okay. So,
but they would miss that deadline.
Right.
And August 5th would be the next special.
Right, and that's my question.
November would be the next actual general.
Yeah. Right, and that's my question. I want to be fair with everybody. So now we tell her if she starts this process that she has to get rid of it until she finishes the process.
Good question. I mean, it's an enforceable offense.
I know it is.
It is.
I understand that it is. I understand wholeheartedly. But I think it's wrong.
Offense.
But I think it's wrong.
They could get an attorney and put a stay on
it. I mean, is there something we can do to say we're going to put a hold on it? I don't want to abolish the ordinance.
I mean, if our
is there something we can do to say
if our legal director was here, you are opening it up for the city to now pick and choose which ordinances you are enforcing.
I don't think legally we could do that.
With the citizen on the phone, I told him we work with her. We are allowed to give extensions off a certain violation. We can work with her on that. But to say that we're going to turn our eye and wait till she gets it on the ballot. No, we're asking for legal trouble out the wazoo, because the next person we go and send a violation out for tweak chickens, now we've already set precedents.
Would you do me a favor?
Day, I feel for her, I feel for the situation, and this, I'm going to just say it very honestly. When you move into a new city, it is your responsibility to check the ordinance of that city that you move into. It is pretty common nature, I don't care what city you came from, that farm animals are not usually allowed in the city limits. So I told her that we would work with her and give her an extension, but for us to say that we're going to sort of turn our eye till she gets on the ballot, I can't allow that, because now we're setting up for potential lawsuits down the road.
I do understand that. But
yeah.
Are you finished, Mr. Lauer?
That's unfortunate.
Well, I didn't get the answer I was looking for, but yes, I'm finished.
Mr. Frederick.
I know I have very limited knowledge of potbelly pigs. I am aware that they are considered a domesticated animal. You cannot show them in a state fair or county fair as a pig or swine. They're in the same classification, to the best of my knowledge, as a cat or a pig or, you know, the, I hate to say, skunks and, yeah, not pig, I'm that dog, thank you. I think what Mr. Lowry was looking for, and I think we can do that, even though the law director is not here to advise, maybe we can get an opinion from her during a break or something. I don't know if that's possible. I think if this lady, which is a citizen, is going to do a referendum and put something on the ballot, that we should give some type of leeway. Of course, she'd have to stay in constant contact with Mr. Britt, and I mean like a monthly contact, to let him know, you know, you still have the pig, you haven't got rid of it or whatever. I think we can do something like that temporarily to let her have time to get this thing on the ballot. It's obvious to me she does not know she can go that route, or she probably already would have when she was out getting these. You said you had 250 signatures, ma'am?
I have 250 actual signatures that are here in New Carlisle. I have 12,000 total, basically all over the United States.
Well,
which doesn't matter, and I know that. The 250 is what I have, and I've done like three blocks.
Yeah,
so.
Unfortunately, the ones out of New Carlisle won't help you.
I know that, but I have a lot more walking to do. I will cover every bit of New Carlisle.
Well, I think you have enough signatures for your referendum, but you have to, initiative, I mean, it would have to be, what, Mr. Carter?
I need to know what the format is that it needs to be in so that it's valid for you guys.
Can I speak to that?
Absolutely.
Can I jump in here?
Yes.
Missy, there's two directions you can go. You obviously have a petition, and you can get as many signatures as you can from people
yes.
who live here in town.
Yes.
And present that to council. Council has the option of whether or not they present new legislation and change it. So that's an option.
Okay.
Or you have the option of an initiative petition, which you would need to go to the Clark County Board of Elections mm-hmm. and get their advice and understand how you would do it correctly, because a lot of times in the past, individuals have had problems with correctly doing their initiative petition, and then it goes through a process and never ends up on the ballot.
Okay.
Those are your two options at this point in time.
Okay, so if I choose to give them my petition that I have tonight and you guys rule against it, can I still put it on the ballot?
Need to go speak with them, because one of the things about signatures on a petition, it has to be on one of their petitions
okay.
from the county, and all these individuals have to be registered voters
okay.
in New Carlisle.
Okay.
Okay. So there's some steps you have to go through to actually do that. I think council could sit here tonight and talk about all your options, but those are really your only two options
right.
okay.
at this point in time.
Okay. I will take my chances and put it on the ballot then. I will save my petition that I have for now. I'll get the correct format and I'll follow through with that. In the meantime, what am I okay to keep my pig? That's what I need to know.
You want my advice?
Yes.
That's where
I'm can I give her some advice?
Sure. You're not a councilman. I wish you would.
As an individual who owns a potbelly pig, but I do not live in the city, I live out in the country where you're allowed to have one.
Yes.
What do you want?
Okay. I would find somebody who would keep that pig for you until you would get this put on the ballot. I would remove the issue whatsoever of that being an issue, because that's a tough one. I'm not sure if I was sitting here that I would vote for an extension, because then I got to do it for Joe Blow, who lives down the street from me, and everybody else. I would find someone that you're close to and
that
would keep it
to.
For you until this may be resolved.
I choose not to do that if I don't have to, because she will act out and she will come back and be angry with us. So I will see what all the council, what their opinions are, and go from there, I guess.
Can I interject?
Sure.
This is not a disrespect.
Wait 1 second. I'm going to step in here first. Well, I've been waiting for 10 minutes, so I'm going to go. On this issue, I think most importantly is they have the option of petitioning, like we've said, number one. Number two, my question, you said that we can't get variances here and there with certain codes because we might get sued for it.
This is not a variance.
I'm saying that we give these variances, we can't get special treatment. So what's the difference between a variance for giving her, and calling it a variance, for giving her the ability to keep the pig until it's referendumed or not, or initiatives, sorry, or giving a business a referendum for a sign, initiative,
variance
for a sign?
Like I'm building a front porch in my house, and I'm 5 feet closer to the back of the sidewalk than I'm allowed to be. That's
right.
But the law says something otherwise. I'm not following your idea, because if the law says you can't build it there, then you can variance to that issue. Maybe I'm dumb and don't understand it, but how I see it is, if the law says the porch stops here, and you get a variance for it. The law says you can't have a pig, but we get variance for business. Maybe I just don't understand what you're saying.
The code is one thing. That's a whole separate discussion we're talking with here.
Exactly.
When it comes down to, this is what I was going to say before you wanted to go, and this is not a disrespect. In order for council to even modify this ordinance, you guys have to reintroduce it and appeal it or modify it again, right. Since it's already passed,
right.
As is.
It has to be enforced. You as individual council members cannot pick and choose what ordinance to enforce or to modify an ordinance that's already been passed.
Exactly.
So at the end of the day, I understand the situation, I talked to her on the phone, you know, it's just, you can't sit there and pick and choose which one to enforce. A variance for building a setback and a variance for having a pig in the city, there is no variance to having a pig in the city. This is not how that particular code section works. First and foremost, that's under animals, which is 618, which is enforceable in one way. And then you have the building code, which is, I think, 1280, which is a whole different set of things that go on. So I understand the situation, it's very difficult, but at the end of the day, the ordinances are in place, the pig is in the city limits. She was violated for that pig. I would stand by our code enforcement officer for violating them, because I'll tell you what, if I was a code enforcement officer, I would have had to do the same thing 2 years ago with the chicken. So it is what it is at this point in time. I would love to sit there and say, yes, keep your pig. Anyone who knows me knows I love animals. Keep your pig. I would love for her to say that. That's not my job. My job is to follow and enforce the ordinances in place. If she puts it on the ballot initiative and it passes and it's gone, more power to you. And that's great. I would really advise that not to pass, because what are we, 2.1, 2.3 square miles? We got 6,000 people densely populated in that one small footprint. Yeah, it may be all nice and flowers for a while with those pigs, but you gotta think 5, 10, 15 years down the road. Now these pigs are breeding, and now we got hot-bellied pig breeders in town. So there's a whole slew of things that need to go wrong, and I think everybody's missing the picture. At the end of the day, I can get a monkey, teach it how to go to the bathroom, put it on a leash, train it to drive a car, say it's a person, at the end of the day, it's a monkey. It's not a livestock question, it's not if it's a family pet option, it comes down to what that animal is legally classified as.
Okay, I have a problem there. You said let a monkey drive. My pig is not gonna leave my yard. A monkey driving, yes, that is hazardous to the town. My pig is going to stay in my backyard and in my house. I've lived here for 2 years, I've had the pig. The whole time I've lived here, it's been in my yard, and most of you probably don't even know I've had her.
Unfortunately, ignorance of the law doesn't make it right.
And I know that.
So, you know, that's what we're stuck with, you know? That's what we're stuck with.
So my question is, do I get to keep my pig until I can put this on ballot?
No.
No.
No. No.
Then we contact our attorney and go about it that way?
You have the right. You're not taking a pig out of my house. You have the right to do that.
Okay.
Because no one's taking a pig out of my house.
Even if I keep it in my house and it is in my house as an indoor pet and does not go outside, I am not allowed to have it.
It is still a violation of the ordinance.
You're cited under animal enclosures, which includes yards, houses, anything's enclosed.
Yeah, I was reading it today.
So are you going to go in everybody's house around here and check and see what kind of animal they have? Because I know that there are numerous pigs.
If there's a complaint, then yes. I mean,
you how code enforcement works is when it's brought to our attention, whether it be somebody reporting it, or a code enforcement officer drives down the street and sees it, that's when we react to it. There's too many moving parts to go ahead and violate everybody, you know, for something that I feel you. I mean, I understand you're complaining that I did code enforcement for about 2 years before I became city manager.
You also told me the ordinance would not be changed.
No, I don't think it will.
That's just his opinion.
And I gave that opinion based off two and a half years ago. I had violated a homeowner up in Northwoods for having chickens. And this lady did the exact same stuff that you're doing. Come in here explaining how much she liked her chickens, there was therapy for her. Just bawling. It was very depressing. It was very upset. But at the end of the day, we have ordinances that we have to enforce. And it's nothing against one particular person. And I guarantee you, I know for a fact, there's. You can go down one street and tag somebody for something and then miss it four times on the street over. So there's too many different moving parts to be 100% accurate with code enforcement. Do you think a cop gets everybody who speeds down 75 or 675? So it's the same thing. You know, if you're not in this profession and you kind of look at it from a amateur, and I don't say amateur, someone who doesn't work in this every day, I'm right there with you. It seems like, why is this me and not this person, this person, this person? But when you do it for a living and you see how it operates, you get a different perspective. Again, I feel for your situation. It's not anything personal. I would love for you to keep that pit. I don't want that bond to be broken at all. But unfortunately, I have a job.
So if I don't get rid of my pig, what happens?
We'll probably give you another extension because I'm assuming that you want one for an extension. If it's not taken out of the property at that point in time, we will take our next steps, and that is to remove the pig.
You will come in and remove the pig yourself?
No, we'll probably get some police officers to accompany us and get a particular person trained.
You step foot on my property, you're trespassing.
That's okay. Fair enough.
You gotta have a warrant.
Okay, so listen, guys, this is where we're at.
Okay.
We've heard the options. Unfortunately, what he said is we all agree, almost, I'm gonna say, that, yeah, you cannot keep it. One or two more extensions, it sounds like, is possibly in the future. No?
No, I mean, yeah, we'll definitely work with her to watch future homes.
But not until August. And August would be your next best chance to get it on the ballot.
All right, so what, do I need to call you to see when my extension is, or are you just gonna give me another zoning violation?
I'll get with our code enforcement officer, we'll send you out a letter or give you a call.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Also, learn how to spell my name.
I don't spell.
For those of you, excuse me, sir.
Don't do that.
You're not making things better.
Don't do that.
Don't be pointing.
You're not making things better.
Not making any better. Not making any better.
He just threatened me, sorry, about catching me off screen.
Yeah, absolutely do.
For those of you who just come in, we still are wrapping up the first meeting, which is the city council meeting, and then we're gonna move on to the town hall meeting. So we will try and get through these next few ordinances, and then we'll start in on the town hall. So if anybody else had any comments or questions before we move into town hall, Ms. Cooter?
You have two different people up here, one to talk to.
Oh, okay.
The one with the mask.
Okay, Ms. Cooter, can we let her go since she was up there? Do you mind? I didn't see her. I apologize.
Hi, my name's Danita Carsey. I live at 513 Hamilton Avenue in New Carlisle. And I sent a letter and an attachment to the city council members and to Mr. Bridge regarding the acquisition of Bell Manor.
Yes.
I don't know if I need to, how I need to get that into the record, but I thought at a minimum I'd read some more things that I find interesting. Basically, there have been studies done of arts organizations that acquire $1 buildings, which is what we're proposing to do here in our town. And what they have found is that most of these arts organizations end up 17 years down the road, 25 years down the road, still in dire financial straits from having accepted this $1 building, because it seems like such a wonderful deal. But I've got a friend who worked at Bell Manor and said they weren't maintaining anything there. I think if we do our due diligence, which means we actually go out and find out what shape the building is in, it's 70 years old. It's 10 times the size of the city hall we have now. I don't think there's a rational person who can say that this building is not going to be incredibly more expensive than what we're paying in rent or what we would pay in increased rent should we experience a 10, 15, 20% increase. Mm-hmm. So some of the things that I found interesting were, and they seem to fit us pretty appropriately, is that almost all study participants voiced regrets that they did not conduct a rigorous upfront evaluation and planning to inform their decisions. Interviewees described entering these deals without comprehensive knowledge of the buildings themselves or the short-term and long-term financial implications of acquisition. They were subsequently surprised by the elements of their new spaces and the extent of repair work required. One group realized post-acquisition that its facility did not comply with building codes because it had no sprinklers. Another was shocked to find its space filled with waste and rundown equipment from a prior inhabitant. But I think these are some of the things that really I keyed on, is an opportunistic mindset on the from the, let's say from the arts organizations, or in our case from our city, we really think that this is going to be a good thing for our city. And so we're, pardon me, I think you were quoted as walking on eggshells so that we don't appear greedy. Well, this company wants to get rid of that building pretty badly because they want out from under their tax bills. They went out from under a 70-year-old building that dropped from $1.2 million in value to about $700,000 in value. Now, where'd the $500,000 in value go? Where it went was deferred maintenance. They're not maintaining the building. That's going to be up to us. So suddenly we're going to be on the hook for a 70-year-old building that's 10 times the size of what we currently have. I don't think we've... Do we have a profit and loss statement projected?
No, it's not finished at this point in time.
Okay, so we haven't done our due diligence yet. And yet we're on the cusp of accepting this building. So we have an opportunistic mindset, which I don't think is how we should approach it. We should approach it with, prove to us that this building is worth our while. Prove to us that we can financially maintain this building and that we're not going to have to raise taxes or cut city services in order to do it. Rapid timelines is another item here. And I think we are in a rush to accept this. We haven't had consultants in to look at the building. I'm not sure how much we've had accountants in to understand. I'm a CPA. Retiring out of Kansas and Ohio this year. So I have a mindset that says, prove to me that this is good before I take your word for it. Sorry, I'm an auditor, so that's what I do. There's a lack of facility expertise here. I don't think we have anybody who's a building manager or who has the expertise to be a building manager. And yet for a building this size, especially if we think we're going to rent it, we're going to need to hire a building manager. Some organizations invested in consultants and other outside experts, but many lack the funds or awareness to do so. In a few instances, many cited the lack of expertise as a chronic problem during acquisition. Lack of staff capacity. 5 organizations do not have full-time staff at the time of acquisition. We know we do have full-time staff. By the way, how many do we have full-time employees for the city?
Overall?
Yeah.
20, 21.
Does that include the water and sewer?
Yes.
Does that include fire?
No.
Okay. How many do we have in administration?
One, two, three, four.
Okay. Because I understand that we're outsourcing our income tax.
Yep.
But we're maintaining the staff who were doing the income tax for the next year to oversee this?
Yeah, but we didn't hire the additional staff needed to maintain, so we've been working under.
Okay. Is it going to cost us to outsource this?
Well, of course, there's a fee for outsourcing, but the bottom line is we're going to be turning a profit.
Okay, but we're outsourcing and we're maintaining the staff who used to do the function.
The staff, the lady who was our full-time tax administrator retired. We have brought her back to June to foresee this conversion, and then in June we will analyze her position at that point in time.
Okay. Anyway, lack of staff capacity. I don't think we have any building facilities experts, but I think we need to have building facilities experts if we acquire a building of this size. So again, new staff, where's the money going to come from? One of the things I know is that I just retired. I think we have a grading of our city, which means we're already an older population than many towns. And we're aging in place. We're all happy here as it stands, so we're gonna stay. We're just not gonna pay taxes to you anymore. So if we're not gonna pay taxes, where's the revenue gonna come from to maintain the city? And lack of access to financial resources. I really do wonder how we're prepared to fund something that I see as being so expensive. Right now, and correct me if I'm wrong, I thought I got this from you. The rental on our city building is $21,600 a year, $1,800 a month.
1850, something like that.
Okay. So you're looking at taking gangbusters worth of risk to save $21,006. Now that's offset by the fact that they'll get out from under $18,000 in tax bill, a chunk of which comes to the city. So I know this $1 building sounds like it's just a fabulous thing. But we haven't done well on our financial attempts in the past. We're currently on the hook, sorry, I'm gonna put it that way. We're on the hook for Twin Creeks bonds until 2035. And as far as I can tell, we're on the hook for Madison City School forever. Nobody wants to buy it for a dollar. So I really think that we need to do a lot of upfront due diligence and not act like paupers who are willing to accept this building when we don't know what shape it's in, but we do know it's 70 years old, and we're responsible for that forever. And thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
If anybody wants a copy of this or if I need to hand it over to have it ready for the record, please let me know.
Can I ask some, a few questions for I'll be honest with you, I have not read your email or your attachment word for today.
Okay.
The condition of the buildings that these arts groups took in, what were they?
Actually, most of them, some of them were
empty,
had deferred maintenance, mm-hmm. as I think Bell Manor does. Mm-hmm. But a lot of them were actually hubs of the community, so they were well-recognized buildings, mm-hmm. theaters, those types of things,
yeah.
that were primary to the city. And so the city arts organizations had a vested interest in doing it. And that's one of the reasons they were able to fundraise. I don't think we're going to be able to fundraise for Bell Manor.
Okay, well, here's the difference, and I think this may alleviate some of your stuff. I read your email and through the phone conversation with very intelligent, I did enjoy our phone call. Sandy Gerber actually is the guy behind this. All right, Sandy Gerber, who was the owner of Bell Manor.
Okay.
Sandy Gerber never would have came into the picture.
That's right.
This Bell Manor donation never would have been there. Them wanting to give us the building has nothing to do with the state it's in. It's in fantastic shape. We have a previous phase one that says that. This is a state-inspected nursing home on a yearly basis. It's an active nursing home under one roof, okay?
Right.
So a lot of people go to think that these hidden issues can very fall down. But that's not the case at all. Mr. Gerber wanted to leave this to the city. That was it. That was why this whole thing got started.
Where did $500,000 in city and county valuation go?
And well, my question is when you got your first valuation, was it, you said 1.2? What year was that?
2014.
And then now in 20, when's the last time?
It was after the crash, by the way.
After the crash. But the value that we have on it, I think, was about $900,000. So I think there's a lot of things going on social media that gives wrong information, quite frankly. At the end of the day,
this is from the county website, not from social media.
Well, I'm not saying your particular information. I'm saying in general, just people talking on social media. But I think this is a case where people just automatically assume it's going to turn into Madison's other Madison Street School, and it's an apples to oranges comparison. Yep. And
give me a profit and loss. So give me a profit and loss, and let us all see it.
Mm-hmm.
Project out the actual revenues for the city, mm-hmm. given a graying population.
Okay, well, profit and loss statements are pretty common. So, I mean, everybody knows about profit and loss statements, and we are working on one. But the big component to that is I am working with a major, major department of the county who's not really willing to discuss this yet, and we're getting all this rent pricing stuff down. Bottom line is we have $1,850 in monthly repaying out. Mm-hmm. Well, another thing that nobody's talking is about the rental income, that additional rental income that we're going to get from Bell Manor. There's also two houses that go with that as well. One of those houses is already rented with a tenant, so we get that monthly rent. There's also a parking lot that the Community Health Center rents that we get. We have no tax bill on this. I applaud your efforts. I think that you have dug into this more than any other citizenship, and I applaud that. But at the end of the day, we are looking at something that I'm not saying it's going to be cheaper than what we're paying now. I think it's going to be just a tad bit more, but you got to look at our whole things that we can do with this building and what we lack. Right now, yes, 10% of our original size, but we're salamied in there.
our storage is at the substation. It's getting ready to collapse and fall over. That substation house is in bad shape. Ask these two gentlemen at the end. That department thought the police will move over to Bell Manor. We will be able to have a legit senior citizens area for our citizens with a community room. We have a commercial grade equipment kitchen with equipment that's coming with this donation that we will be able to use as a second shelter house or to rent out that commission for a kitchen for somebody to come in and bake. So I understand what you're saying. I truly, truly do. We're not going to save tons of money from moving in there. I mean, nobody's saying we're not going to need overhead at all.
Right. And I understand that you really want this building.
But you know, profit and loss statements, when you're doing these things in the future with all these unknowns, they're kind of just best guesses. So right now, this best guess is trying to get as best as we can possibly get for any information that's pulled out. Somebody had asked me, what about our DP&L monthly charge? I have no clue. I'm just going to be very honest. I can't tell you that. DP&L won't even tell you that. But the last thing I'm going to do is call over there and ask what your monthly average is, because what their DP&L consumer uses are versus what we're going to be are going to be this and this.
So take hours and ratchet it up 10 times.
I'm sorry?
So take hours currently and ratchet it up 10 times.
I don't think ours would go up by 10% because we're not taking over the whole footprint of the building. We're going to have other people in there.
You're not going to be able to part out part of the building either.
Excuse me?
You're not going to be able to have the building.
Sure you can.
Yeah,
can.
We're taking the whole building.
No, well, we're not having it. It's like cutting it in half and making a courtyard in between there.
Well,
but
you're
there
not
are ways
seal
to
seal it off and not keep half of it.
No, there's going to be other departments in there from the county taking that spot where we're not using it.
Yeah,
so that's already been talked about. You know, so I applaud your efforts. The Bell Manor MOU, it is authorized to be signed, but there's still an act for the city. Just because that MOU is signed does not mean that we are bound by the terms of that agreement. You know, we still need to go through with the phase one or asbestos whatever council decides, you know. There's still ways out for that. So it's not like we sign it, we're there, we're done. But I think you take Madison Street School out of this city's previous history, I think that we would have a totally different attitude on it. But again, I applaud your efforts.
I think we still have the Twin Creeks attitude.
Twin Creeks is done and over with.
Yeah, it's over with.
We're still paying on the loans, the actual vacant parcel lawsuit is done.
We sold the parcels for less.
Well, that, yeah, because we had a false bond.
Mr. Bridge, we're steering off here. We've been on the subject for almost 15 minutes now, so we have to press on. But I thank you for coming to the meeting tonight. And, you know, keep in touch with Mr. Bridge if you have any, or any of the council members, if you have any further comments or questions on the building, or come to some of our next council meetings.
Please take a read through the attachment, because I think if you do...
Yeah, I know I got it last when you said it.
I did.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
We're three times today.
Ms. Kubler.
Sure.
Yes.
No, I'm not. Come on, Donna. We haven't heard from you in a while.
All right. I sent you guys a letter about a month ago. January the 17th, but only three of you actually got it because you guys, part of you are new and you were out on the
about dad batting around. Yeah.
So I'm just going to hit on the high spots because I got a few other things I want to hit as much as I can. I think you're making a mistake on the nursing home. We've been in fiscal watch once and I don't want to go back there. And also, the money that it's going to cost to renovate it, I think should be invested in our water department and our streets. And I think I told you that, Rick, didn't I?
You did.
If we've got extra money, that's what we should be taking care of, is the water department and our streets. If there's only four of you, it can't be that crowded up there.
No, that's just administrators. We actually have other staff inside the building.
Anyways, I'm not going to hang around on that too long because I'll come back to it during town hall meeting. But on this water thing, I'll tell you what, John, you've seen this from Oakwood. It lists 66 different areas in the water prices. And we are, congratulations, number 58 at the bottom of 66. So we're already paying an outrageous amount of money compared to everybody else for water.
Whoa.
Well, 58 means we're low.
You're backwards.
What's backwards?
No, I think it's how the building is set up.
Oh, is it set up different?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lowest to highest.
Dean is the lowest.
Okay.
It's the top.
What is that dated, man?
It's from Oakwood. One of the guys that is on Facebook, he says they put it out every year. Oakwood puts it out every year.
They do.
And it lists all the different areas, and it tells what it's based on, the amount of 3 cubic feet of water in a 3-month period. Okay, Ena's was 65.26. That was the low, and the median is 118.13. We're at 163.80. I can give this to you guys. I don't care, but so we're already too high on water. We've had an increase in 2013, 2014, 2015, and then last year we get a 50% increase in our taxes, and then you're asking for raises. I'm trying to figure that one out, because it looks like you had a raise, you, city manager had a raise 2012,
2013, 2014. Donna, not this city manager, though.
Huh?
Not this city manager. He's not had a raise since he's been hired.
Yet to have some. Oh, okay.
Yes.
But anyway,
my original offer was based off my job offer that was part of the actual right. job offer, which I will add that I'm working below that because the union stopped in and prevented me from getting my full agreed dollar amount before I took over. So I have not had a raise since I've studied. Technical raise.
The earlier city manager raises were for city manager Kim Jones.
But we still are paying for it.
Right, I'm just letting you know. I just wanted you to separate the two.
I'm not picking on him, but I'm just telling you what I'm reading. Finance director, service director, 2013, 2014, they got raises. And then last year, finance director, service director. And then this year, you got a 3.5 proposal to vote on tonight. I'm just telling you what's on the line, okay? So then I went to the tax records in Clark County to look at this Bell Manor. And what she's talking about, it did. It dropped from $1,250,060 in 2012 to $718,900 in 2013. I don't know if you guys have done a title search, but there's something like 11 D's or something on this place. There was a boatload. It's all topped up, and it was added on to piece by piece. So you got all those deeds. If you don't do a title search and get insurance for your title search, and a cloud on the title shows up, you're screwed. According to this, it belongs to Ruskin Realty. Facilities. But your taxes on it is $17,000 a year. And it shows where they did some remodeling and stuff. But I think that you're getting in over your head, okay? That's just my opinion on that. And I'll visit it again during the town hall meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Coogler.
Certainly, thank you.
Anyone else? Mr. Grimm.
Dale Grimm, 114 South Main Street, and I am not going to complain. I am the planning chairman for the New Calais Farmers Market. Things are moving along. The Farmers Market will be held starting June 24th through September 16th. We have a lot of exciting things planned. We have about 90% firmed up for June 24th. A live radio remote with Andy Lawrence from Hank FM, is that what it is?
Hank 101.5.
Yeah. We also have a well-known bluegrass band, Rum River Blend. They will be performing on July 15th. So I hope everybody comes out for fresh produce, baked goods, crafts, all kinds of goods. Thanks.
Thank you, Dale.
Thank you, Mr. Graham. Anyone else?
Oh, I just wanted to was curious.
Sir, can you come up to the podium? We'll need your name and address for the record, please.
Hi, my name is Bill Jennings. I live at 401 Foxton Avenue here in New Carlisle, Ohio. And I follow different things, read the paper, different things. I saw a presentation, I may be out of line or late, but I saw the ideas of Ethan there about the way to handle a water tower work, coating and things like that. Maybe that's going to be discussed, and maybe I'm inventing the wheel here. Maybe it hasn't been, or we vote, is something being voted on tonight for the, for that tower. Or I think it's a worthy explanation to hear Ethan's ideas on how that money could be used, and maybe this has already been done, and I got here late, so.
Yeah, no, the vote for the water rates is going to be at the town hall meeting, which will take place at the after we finish this one up, and it's scheduled to be at the end of the town hall meeting. So once everybody says their piece, introduces themselves, and all council has their word, then we'll vote and talk on that.
Yeah, I sure appreciate to hear Ethan and I guess Bill, so they were talking about this and how it could be done. And I heard Ethan talk about that. So thanks for your time.
Thank you, sir.
Is there another?
Okay, Nancy Ilbanovich, 505 Pease. I know at one time, Randy, you were talking about renting part of the building to help defray some of the costs. And a couple questions on that is I'm wondering why anybody would want it because of the parking. And the building itself being so chopped up, you're going to have to open up a lot of stuff. And it's not the most beautiful building I've ever seen in the world. The other thing is Family Dollar has been empty up there on the main street for quite some time. So if somebody was going to rent, I think they would want to rent in there. We also, as soon as I look at Bill Manor and I say, gee, they're moving out of town, they're not quitting business. They're just moving out of town. So obviously they don't think the place is worthwhile fixing up because they're going out of town and building new stuff out
there.
Going
out of town.
That would be my impression. I'm sorry, that's my impression. And also, we keep going through this of people not calling in before we get to this point after the council has done a lot of work and put a lot of effort into it, and then they find out people don't want it. So I think we need to find a way to find out people want or don't want these things before we get into it.
Thank you.
Matthew Mills, 1103 Mundale Avenue. I was going to wait until the city meeting to ask this, but we're talking about Bell Manor.
Sir, could you say your name again and your
Matthew
address?
Matthew Mills.
Okay.
1103 Langdale Avenue.
Thank you.
A lot of talk about Bell Manor, kind of close to my heart. I had a grandmother that died there. So regardless, been there a lot. I have a big problem with accepting this. And I know you've probably done a lot of research. I'm sure there's been a lot of studies been done. Is this good for the city? Is it not good for the city? Hasn't been answered yet. How is this good? You know, can somebody explain to us why do we want this? Why does the taxpayer in this building want that building? How does it benefit me? How does it benefit anybody in this room? I don't know if that's been explained yet. Second, the reason why I have misgivings about it, the reason why I've been talking, you know, intelligently about this is that I have a background in construction management. I manage phase one and phase two hazardous material environmental surveys. What's upsetting to me is hearing that the city's going to pay or not receive as much compensation for redoing a survey that was done 3 years ago. There's no mandate, there's no EPA code, there's nothing that requires us as an organization, as anybody, to redo a survey that's already been done. There's nothing required. There's been no new construction, there's been no anything that would require an additional survey to perform. I ran the New Carlisle Sun, $6,000 to have another survey done. Again, this is New Carlisle Senate information. Just reading it, don't know how accurate it is. I don't think the taxpayer should have to spend $6,000 on that survey. Phase one, just so everybody knows what phase one is, that means you go out, you talk to the owner, you understand this is the building, this is what's in it. That's all it is. Then you have to go through phase two to where you actually have to take samples, take a test for asbestos, take a test for lead paint. You have to do that. Then after, you pay somebody money to get the phase two survey done. Then you have to pay somebody to actually do the abatement. I don't know if that's ever been explained fully in this body. I just, you know, I know this. I manage the type of work. So when I hear that the city's going to spend another $6,000 on a study that doesn't need to be done, in my opinion, it's upsetting.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Bridge.
What was his name? I'm sorry, Mr.
Matthew Mills.
Mr. Mills. Phase one is only valid for 180 days after it's done.
By what code?
By the industry standards. I got
industry's,
that.
Yep. I am a member of the industry, okay. Sir, and there's no code that is regulated by the Ohio EPA, and there's nothing stating that.
Okay, so industry standards was 180 days. The $6,000 is not the cost of the phase one, okay? It's $1,500 if they want to recertify that phase one, okay? The big chunk of that cost comes from the asbestos survey and study. $4,000 of that is from that. So phase one, yeah, you're right. It's probably going to tell us nothing's changed. But I tell you what, if I was a member of that council and I'm very receive a $1 million building as a gift to add to my tax, I mean, to my overall profile of the city, I'm going to make sure for $1,500 everything, nothing's changed from that phase one. And the asbestos study has never been done before. Okay, so everybody talks about going in and redoing Bell Manor. There's nothing that we need to redo. There's no walls we have to put up. So if we have to build a council chambers in there, which we'll probably end up doing, that's the only major renovation we need to do. But even that is not a major renovation. The rural walls are already there. The asbestos is needed because if we ever do rip up a carpet tile or move council chambers, we're going to need to know where that asbestos is and we need to know where to get it done. So again, the cost of the phase one is not $6,000. To recertify that is $1,500. The big chunk of that whole $6,000 cost we see was from the asbestos survey and study. So again, when you are about to acquire a building of that nature, you want to make sure that all your I's and T's are crossed. And I would not be doing my job as a city manager if I did not give them, the seven people of the council, the decision, the information to make their decision. But how many of you would buy a house without getting inspected, regardless if that house was just bought 6 months ago, 8 months ago? You know, I think people get caught up on this $6,000. And I saw the social media feeds, everybody saying the study that it shouldn't cost $6,000 for phase one. Well, they're right, it shouldn't, because it does cost $1,500 to get that recertified. Again, a large part of that cost comes from the asbestos survey and study. That is very crucial. If this council wasn't going to pick which study to do, I would say pass on the phase one and get the asbestos done.
Mr. Lyman.
Two things. First, Bell Manor did not leave the city. It's still within the city limits. Okay. And sir, did you say, and I'm sorry, I don't remember the name, did you say there has been an asbestos study done at Bell Manor?
According to the New Carlisle Sun, a phase one study was performed for $6,000. I'm going off the New Carlisle Sun. It was printed based off of this February 21st.
That's not correct information.
Okay.
Apparently, it's incorrect information.
Okay. Okay. So I'm asking you, since you're involved in that, should an asbestos study be done then? Because unless I misunderstood you, I thought you said once it's done, it doesn't have to be done again in any length of time if there's no new construction. So if you know something about it, we don't, I would love to hear it is what I'm getting at.
So here's how it goes. There's a phase one and there's a phase two. A phase one is strictly just, I'm an environmental survey company. I'm gonna go meet with you. I'm gonna understand the history of the
okay.
When was it built? When was it additions? When was construction?
Okay.
From that, then you can go through and you can understand, okay, there could be the potential for lead paint. There could be the potential for an underground fuel storage tank. There could be the potential for asbestos. There could be the potential for this or for that.
Okay.
That is a phase one.
Okay.
A phase two is where you come in and you say, all right, phase one said there's a potential for this material. Now I'm going to go through and I'm going to survey this building and actually get samples of different things. Okay, you know, this building's so old, chances are it has this much type of material in it. Could be lead paint, could be asbestos. You actually go and you take samples of subject material.
Okay.
That may cost $10,000, depends on how big the building is.
Okay.
Then, after you do that, that's just to take the samples. Then you have to go through, and if something's actually found, that company has to go out, and by law, they have to bid it out to an abatement contractor, that if you're going to do anything in that space, it's only if you're going to do something in the space that's going to do any renovation right. or whatever. They then make it a scope of work to where that company has to go, and they have to remove that. Bid it out to three companies by law, and they remove it. So it's not just a simple matter of, oh, I found asbestos, that's the cost. It's, I found asbestos, this is how much it costs to find it. Now I have to bid it out and have it removed.
Okay.
So when you hear, you know, again, I'm going off the information that I heard.
Right, I understand.
In the sun. So to me, again, as a citizen, it doesn't seem like it's worth it to spend all this money for an investment for something we still don't understand what the benefit is.
Okay.
And to spend money, even if it's only $1,500 for phase one,
okay.
and $4,500 for phase two, tell us what the benefit is before we go spending our money, regardless of what the cost is, regardless of how small it is, tell us what the benefit is.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
But if phase one, tell me if there's underground tanks on site.
I'm sorry?
But if phase one, tell me if there's underground tanks on site.
It should.
Okay.
I don't think there is.
There was. I was just making sure.
Real quick. Matt, that's why I wanted you to come tonight. I mean, we're all smarter because you just showed up. I mean, seriously, thank you for coming. I'm now better to understand everything. Please stay in contact as we move forward with this. But just real quick on things that could be beneficial, a lot of things I've contemplated and thought about when I was going through interviews with council. One of the questions was, you know, what are some good things you could see? And I'm going to keep this brief and move on. But let's say there's somebody's house burns down. You know, right now there's no place for that person to go, like if they don't belong to a local church or, you know, they want to spend a night, you know, outside the city limits. That's some place where a family could go, like with little kids, and I'm talking about myself too. Like, you know, we have three little kids. If something were to happen, that building can be fit to take care of somebody, you know, for 1, 2, 3 weeks, if need be. For natural disasters, resources, people can come in, they can eat. So it's basically we can use that as a community center. Obviously, we have maybe a bigger space where we can hold all these people for these meetings. And also opportunities to rent out. And I know it's kind of tough to see. You know, there's no guarantee of renting anything because, you know, the question was, well, who's going to want to move in there? But, you know, there are opportunities. So hopefully that answers your question a little bit. But with that being said, again, thanks.
Do you mind if I consult you moving forward?
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else before we move on? All right, I think we got it. We might get to the town hall tonight. let's see. Okay, so no committee reports tonight, so we'll drop down to resolutions.
Resolution 17-04R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution amending resolution 16-13R, the capital improvement program for the city of New Carlisle, Ohio, for the purchase of the second police vehicle in 2017.
Mr.
Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay. I move we accept resolution 17-04R.
Second.
Give it to the kid.
You're here longer than you.
I have a motion by Mr. Lindsay and a second by Mayor Lowry.
An explanation of this resolution.
No.
That was the second by Ethan.
Second was Ethan.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yeah. Mr. Reynolds.
What'd you point at you then? I heard three voices.
Okay, well, it was Mr. Reynolds.
Yeah.
All right. Sorry.
Yes,
Explanation of this resolution. At the last budget work session, the council wanted us to amend the CIP to allow us to buy a second police vehicle this year. So that's the legislation that we have in front of it. Also with that new legislation for the police vehicle is also amending the CIP for sirens and what we call a light fitting.
Council, any questions? Mr. Collier, are you ready? Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Resolution 17-04 passes 7-0. Thank you, sir. Moving on to ordinances when you're ready. Ordinance 17-03, public hearing and action tonight. An ordinance establishing compensation rates for certain management personnel.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to table 17-03.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Krabacher to table, second by Mr. Lethley.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Reynolds.
How long would this, if we're tabling, for what length of time is it? Permanent table? Is it going to come back?
No, it'll come back in a month.
It can be reconsidered. It'll be reconsidered.
Okay. Just checking.
Is that a reasonable time?
Anyone want to give an explanation as to why you're tabling, or would you like me to take it?
How are you, sir?
I had put this ordinance for our raises on here strategically at this point in time for this reason. Our budget's looking fantastic. I am not paid out of the water rates. Mrs. Harris is not paid out of the water rates. Mr. Kipko is paid 25% out of the water rates. In reality, I should be paid out of the water rates. Mrs. Harris should also be paid out of the water rates. But since it's not a very healthy enterprise fund, the general fund has to pay our salaries. So I conjoined our increase for our management raises with our budget because our general fund budget and a lot of other aspects of our budget looks phenomenal. Better when it has been used. I have not taken a raise since I started. Ms. Harris is still severely underpaid. We have, and you'll hear in town hall tonight how much we have saved the city over the past 2016. So we were asking for a 3.6% raise over 3 years. But we did want to table that because I did want to put the council in a position to have to vote on a raise and water rate increases, even though our pay has nothing to do with the water rate increase except for 25% of Mr. Kitko's pay. So we all have jobs. Most of us in here have jobs. We all get raises. It is nice to be rewarded when you do a good job. So me asking for a 3.6% raise over the course of 3 years, which is 1.2% a year, I didn't think it was asking for too much. But I understand some of the member council's concerns about having this vote on the same day as water rate increases. So with that being said, I talked to the three managers that were up for raises. We have decided to table those to a later date.
Thank you, sir.
No problem.
Mr. Collier. Continue, sir. Mr. Krabacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
Yes.
Ordinance 1703 was tabled and passes 7-0. Ordinance 17-04, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into any and all agreements on behalf of the city of New Carlisle for the signal upgrade project, Clark State Route 235 4.44/4.77, including but not limited to the Ohio Department of Transportation.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to adopt 17-04.
Second.
Mr. Reynolds on the second.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, this is actually good news. I've been working on this for quite some time now. A little while ago, I pulled off the playground to put in the donation, so I wanted to be that my surprise. So you see that nice playground, putting it up there. That was 100% grant funded. We had a unique opportunity when I took over as city manager. I've always wanted in our most prominent intersections, and that would be 571 and 235, and also the speedway intersection, Lake and Main.
something nice. I wanted those new and improved, very modern light poles that have come out like this, and they go over, and there's a little street light there. So, in 2019, correct? You want to start?
Between 2019 and
2020. 2019 and 2020, the city will 100% fund, no cost to the city whatsoever, have two massive signalization upgrades. This will be one will be located at 571 and 235. Going to have a nice banister come out. We're going to take away a lot of those poles that are just unsightly. We're going to have one banister come out on my side from across. There's some decorative lighting. This street sign right there will say 571 and 235. It will be affixed at the top and bottom. We haven't determined yet. And it will also be lit up at night. So again, this is a $550,000 project that we got 100% funded, no cost to the city. That will do multiple things. The first and foremost is traffic congestion is a bear on 235 and 571. Council passing this ordinance tonight just allows me to sign off on any agreement that we have leading up to this. There will be public hearings along the way because of the cost of the project, but more importantly, it will be up to the citizens and council members to decide if you guys want turn lanes added on 235 and 571. Right now there are no turn lanes except for on the east side of 571. So what that will do is we'll create turn lanes heading north and south on 235 and then west on 571. We got a lot of truck traffic coming down 235, sometimes backed up. We did not want to make that call with the turn signals. So part of that public hearing would be council, citizens, you guys can get together to decide if you want this turn lane added or not. Turn lanes will not make or break this project. We will still go through with it, with or without the turn lane being added. Now that being said, we will be also doing some upgrades to our parking lot, municipal parking lot right there off Church Street, to kind of conjunct with this possible alleviation of four or five parking spaces on either side of the road. So, with that being said, here later on this year, we're going to start taking out all the striping and all the guardrails of the community parking lot, resurface it, restripe it, make it all nice and pretty. But I did want to bring up the fact that we have an awesome, great opportunity here to get new signalization, $550,000 project at zero cost.
Thank you.
A couple big things is the funding comes from CMAQ. It's congestion mitigation air quality. The reason we got that funding is those two signals will interconnect. Okay, they'll communicate with each other. The other thing is there'll be radar instead of interconnect loops or loops in the roadway that have difficulty with motorcycles. So there'll be radar projecting out a signal for an object sitting there on the street. The other thing is they'll go to all LED. And of course, we pay the electric bill for those signals currently, and they're all old-fashioned incandescent cabinets. And then one is the cabinet that sits at CVS gets hit all the time by semis. So we'll be moving the poles back, getting them off the intersection with that too. So one is electric savings, and then all this is federal tax dollars that are coming back to the city. And that's all I have.
We have an open seat over here if anybody wants in front of the door.
This one. All right. When you're ready, Mr. Collier.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Ordinance 1704 passes 7-0.
Moving on to the next ordinance, whenever you're ready, Mr. Collier.
Does council understand why we have 17, 8, 9, and 10?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, I just want to make sure everybody's on the same page for moving forward.
Does everybody understand?
Yeah. Ready, Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Ordinance 17-08E, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to sign an agreement with CTL Engineering for a Phase 1 environmental site assessment and an asbestos study on Bell Manor Nursing Home in preparation for the possible donation of Bell Manor Building to the City of New Carlisle and declaring an emergency.
Counsel. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion for 1708E.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Krabacher and a second by Mr. Reynolds.
Any discussion, counsel?
Oh, I'm sorry. I was reading it. This one got. Explanation of this ordinance, this would allow the city to go ahead with both the phase one and the asbestos survey.
Mr. Bridge.
Yes, sir.
In your knowledgeable professional opinion, and you may consult with this gentleman back here, should we go ahead and do the phase one, or should we bypass on it and go strictly to the phase two?
No.
I'm asking you your opinion on this one.
You don't need a phase two.
You only do a phase two if you have a phase one.
That says something.
Situation.
Okay.
Yeah. Here's the deal. If I were one of you seven up there, I would spend the $1,500 just to cover my butt. I would. But you have a unique situation here. You are seven people who have to make the decision. And you got a lot of your citizens staring at you right now. So at the very least, I'll be honest with you, I don't think the phase one from 3 years ago is going to change much. But that doesn't mean that you shouldn't have your responsibilities in a row. The least I would do is have the asbestos. That is by far the most crucial aspect of this whole process. Because the moment you go down and tear down a wall, put your council chambers up, and you go rip up the carpet tile, and there's asbestos down there, we're going to need to know where it's at and what do we not have to do to move it. Because there's probably asbestos in there, but as long as you don't go move anything and it's covered up, you're usually good. I would love to hear from Mr. Mills, though, on his opinion.
Yeah, absolutely.
I would like to have your opinion on my
question. Can I make a comment first? Go ahead.
All right.
Go
ahead. Last time I had voted no on this agreement because I thought that we had asked the manager for this letter or the email, and now we've gotten it. I think, personally, we need to know what's in the building. I constantly rail on not knowing what's going on, where we got into the situation with Madison Street School, we got the situation with Twin Creeks, because we were ill-informed. The only way we're going to know what's in the building, and I know that you're a professional at this, but I'm going to trust people being in the ground, telling me what is there, what is going on. I like detail. I love detail, actually. You can ask Mr. Bridge. I constantly ask for it from him. And I think this is something that needs to be done, because I want to know what's in there. If it's asbestos, I mean, look, we had purchased the old Madison Street School building, didn't know it was in there, and then, oh, look, we can't build it there. So I want to know what's in there, so I'm definitely going to support this. I voted no last time, not because I was against it, but because I wanted to see the letter from the company. And they said they weren't paying for it, so we have to. Last time we didn't do this, we got stuck with Madison Street School, and you see it still standing there and rotting and decaying. So this is the best, worst option we have, to put it in the best way possible. So I'm going to vote for this. I know I failed it last time, but I'm for it this time. So I just want to make sure everyone knows why I voted for it and why I'm for it now.
I agree with you.
Okay, I do. What are you talking about?
Yeah, I'm sorry. He was before me.
Age before beauty.
I can't argue. tough. I've been on council a long time. Very seldom do I vote my conscience. I vote what people tell me to vote. I listen to people. Louder. I'm sorry. I have men too, and I think I'm talking loud, and I'm not. I apologize. I try to vote what the citizens of New Carlisle tell me to vote, what they want. I have watched social media. I have seen it all. I cannot vote for this, and I will not vote to acquire Bell Manor Nursing Home. And I think everyone here should vote against it. We just had a meeting, and there has not been one person out of this audience stand up and say, go for Bell Manor. I will tell you straight out, we need it. I'm not saying I know more than anyone in here, but I've been in the building they work out of. It's horrible. I wouldn't work in it. I'd find another job somewhere. There's one office in there that's no bigger than that restroom right there that there's people working in. It's absolutely wrong. We need a building. But you decide, and it's your money, and I will not vote for it unless I hear a whole bunch of people come back to council and say we want the building. But as it stands right now, I can't vote for it, and I will vote no for this and the acquisition of the building. But I'm voting for the people who want to vote that way.
Speaking directly about the phase one and the asbestos, that's part of what I do for a living is financing commercial buildings. And part of that involves getting phase one studies done. I looked at phase one, and there's absolutely nothing in that phase one that gives us any indication that there's a problem. Absolutely nothing. There's only, I should say not absolutely, there was one issue that underneath a generator, they spotted a fuel stain underneath the tanks that fuel the generator. Probably happened when they changed the filter on the generator. So there's, from the best of our knowledge, best of my thinking, you will not have a single change on this phase one if we do it again. From that perspective, I think it's a waste of money. At the same time, I'm gonna waste your money. I don't wanna waste your money. I absolutely believe that we need to know about what the asbestos situation is in there. We have no idea.
Yeah, we don't.
So my opinion is we don't need the phase one, we do need the asbestos, but I will err to the caution of experts. Mm-hmm. So that's my stand.
Council, any other questions, comments? Mr. Lighting.
Waiting on Mr. Mills, what do you think?
There was, you didn't lock it. I don't think it's true for anything because I don't think they need help now. But knowing and understanding you've already got phase one, and knowing and understanding that unless the owner tells you different, that no major construction has been performed in the past 3 years, phase one's a waste of money. Now you're going to talk about $1,500. What's $1,500? But I think it's a waste. So I would say that if you're going to move forward with it, you need to go with the phase two. But there's no reason for phase one.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Whitey. Mr. Collier, when you're ready, sir.
Mr. Lindsay.
I'm going to vote no on this.
Mr. Lighty.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
No.
Mr. Lethley.
No.
Mr. Krebacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Ordinance 17-08E. The vote was actually 4-2. You need 6 votes of council to pass it, so it did not pass.
The rest of the stuff is good.
No. Not myself. Pass this.
When you're ready, sir, let me throw this out to council. We have 17-09E on the agenda next.
Right.
Considering the fact that the one previous did not pass, my personal recommendation is that this motion, this ordinance failed due to a lack of motion after our meeting.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Ordinance 17-09E, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to sign an agreement with CTL Engineering for a phase one environmental site assessment on Bell Manor Nursing Home in preparation for the possible donation of Bell Manor building to the city of New Carlisle and declaring an emergency.
Can we ask a question first? Or the motion. We got a misunderstanding here. That's why I'm at. Okay.
What's the misunderstanding?
Well, I just Jim just said that there's two different issues going on here. So is this a different issue?
No, you have three ordinances for revision of the same thing. Your first ordinance was for the phase one and asbestos combined.
Right.
The second one is just to have phase one done, which is going to die the lack of motion. And then you have the third one that just calls for the asbestos only.
Okay, so all three
which
of them.
Could pass.
Well, the asbestos only study, then we just have the asbestos done. We don't worry about the motion.
Right.
Okay. All right.
That makes sense.
That's what I want to know.
Gene, do I hear a motion?
You do not have a motion.
Okay. I will note that 1709E fell due to a lack of motion. All right.
Ordinance 17-10A, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to sign an agreement with CTL Engineering for an asbestos study and evaluation of Bell Manor Nursing Home in preparation for the possible donation of Bell Manor Building to the city of New Carlisle and declaring an emergency.
Council?
Mr. Mayor?
Mr. Leith?
I move pass ordinance 17-10E.
Second.
Got it. I take it there's no discussion?
No discussion, Council.
No, sir. Mr. Rick Lowry?
No.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
I actually have a quick comment I just thought of. We just failed one for asbestos study, and we're going to pass another one for asbestos study? Because the first one said... The
first one was a combination.
Well, it says, yeah, a combination. So we're going to pass this one.
This is just for the asbestos.
Just asbestos. Right.
Yes.
You said yes, Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
That's what I should. 17-10 passes 6-1.
And the final introduction. You're ready, sir.
We got more.
Ordinance 17-11E, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. You did one.
You got E on
this. 320. What's
320? Okay, let me do that again. Ordinance 17-11E, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 320-17. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to other business.
Wait a minute.
Final meeting will be held on Wednesday, March 8, 2017, here at the Shelter House, starting at 6:30 p.m. So, you want to join on the Crime Watch meeting, they definitely use members in that, so it's really interesting group to be involved with. And if there's nothing else from council or the city manager, we will adjourn and go straight into
the... Mr. Mayor.
Hang on.
No, I was looking at you.
Adjourn. Okay.
We're just taking about 5 minutes.